welcome you all. Presently, we all are having a very tough time facing the COVID outside. But in such a difficult situation, Uttara Ma'am was ready to take our webinar. And as they say, the show must go on. So this is like, although we know it's a tough situation for everybody fighting their own battles, some or the other way they are connected with this COVID scenario. But today we have a very interesting topic. We are taking hand function training in quadriplegics. And we have a very fine speaker with us, Dr. Uttara Mohan. She has an experience of 12 years in the field of neurophysiotherapy. Presently, she is working at the ARG Center, Mumbai, and she is also running her own clinic under the name of Physio Finance. She has a certification in PNF level 1, 2, and 3 from USA. She is a certified neurodynamics practitioner from Australia. She's a certified in Mulligan Technique from Kepri Institute. She had lots of awards in her kitties. She was awarded the Outstanding Achievement in Neuro Rehabilitation as Paraplegic Foundation in 2016, Gandhi Award for Significant Contribution to Neuro Rehabilitation at the Indian Federation of Neuro Rehabilitation Conference in 2017, and Best Clinician Award at Sports Connect 3 Conference in 2021. She has been working on-field physiotherapist at National Wheelchair Sports Conference events from the Paraplegic Foundation Mumbai for past 8 years, and a para RYP swimming competition organized by Paralympic Swimming Association of Maharashtra in 2018 and 2019. She has been the resource person for various webinars, CMEs, national and international conferences. She's also been the resource person in 5 hands-on workshops on spinal cord injury rehabilitation. Welcome you all, ma'am. It's our pleasure to have you here. I think the session will be wonderful and there will be lots of learning process for all the delegates who have joined it. So over to you, Uttara ma'am. We welcome you all from the behalf of IIP Ghaziabad team and the state team. Over to you, ma'am.
Thank you, Dr. Abhijyoti and Ghaziabad team for inviting me to give this webinar. We'll start with the session. So today I'll be talking about hand function training in quadriplegics. So before we start off with discussion about the hand function training, I thought of sharing this about Stephen Hawking. He had said that however difficult life may seem, there's always something you can do and succeed at. So Stephen Hawking also suffered from neurological condition at a young age, but still had a successful career and he's done quite a lot. So similarly, even in quadriplegic, being a quadriplegic doesn't mean that the person needs to be dependent on other individuals for all activities. They can be made independent in many activities, or as far as possible, keep with less assistance, have adaptive devices, and they can be made very independent. This can be achieved by a good rehabilitation technique, which we can provide to the patients. So what is a spinal cord injury? It is an insult to the spinal cord, which results in either temporary or a permanent damage and deficit in terms of sensory, motor, and autonomic function. Some of the spinal cord injury patients might even have a normal recovery or near normal recovery. It's quite common for these patients to have severe neurological deficit even after being rehabilitated. So such kind of patients which don't have a full recovery, our role plays an important aspect in terms of making them functionally independent so that they can continue their daily activity and also their occupation. So here in spinal cord injury, the patients who have injury at the cervical level, they will be the quadriplegics. So in SCI, it can be a complete or an incomplete injury. So in complete injury, there is a complete sensory motor loss below the level of injury, whereas in an incomplete injury, there might be sparing of sensory and motor function below the level of injury. So when it comes to a complete injury, different individuals with the same level of injury will show a similar manifestation. But in case of an incomplete injury, each patient will have a different clinical manifestation depending on which muscles below the level of injury are spared and how much strength they have in those muscles. So their training and their rehab will have to be planned individually based on the impairments that they show. Another important term which you need to know to understand further about the hand function discussion that we'll be having is about the vertebral and the neurological level. So usually in case of spinal cord injury, it's a little higher than the vertebral level. So we need to understand that when a vertebral body or a particular vertebral level, there is a damage, you need to understand the corresponding spinal nerve root, the segment which will get affected. So when it comes to cervical region, though in the upper levels, the spinal nerve segment is at the same level, from C4 to C7 vertebra, for the spinal level, you need to add plus one. T1 to T6, you need to add plus two to know the spinal level. From T7 to T9, you need to add plus three. At T10 level, you have the L1 and L2 spinal nerves. At T11, you have L3, L4. And at T12, you have the L5 nerve. And at L1, you have the sacral segment. Beyond that, it is the cauda equina and the phylum terminal. Okay, so here what we'll be discussing is in terms of the neurological level. When I mention a level, it will be the neurological level which I'm talking about. And I'll be describing the rehab in terms of a complete injury. Because for an incomplete injury, person to person, it will differ based on which muscles are spared. Accordingly, the rehab is going to change. So it is important to know which muscles are spared for each level of injury, because once you know the muscles spared, accordingly, you can plan a rehab for the upper limb movements and for the hand function. For C1 to C4 level, there is no upper limb function. They have good neck movement. They can do levator scapular movement, shoulder elevation, but the upper limb movements are not there. So they cannot be trained to do hand functional activities or any upper limb activities. Most of their function is done by using their neck movement and head control. They maneuver around for the daily routine. When it comes to a C5 level of injury, some muscles are partially innervated, some are completely innervated. As in the muscles, they quite often get innervation from multiple spinal segments. So the muscles which are getting innervation from some intact spinal segments and some of the spinal segments which are affected, then that muscle is going to show a partial innervation. There will be a slight amount of weakness in those muscles, but will be able to do some perform of some amount of movement. Whereas the muscles which get a full innervation, they will have a full strength and good recovery. So in C5 level, there is partial innervation to deltoid, serratus anterior, infraspinatus, teres minor, biceps brachii, brachialis, brachioradialis. There is complete innervation to rhomboideus. In C6 level, there is partial innervation to serratus anterior and latissimus dorsi, whereas complete innervation to deltoid, infraspinatus, teres minor, biceps brachii, and clavicular fibers of pectoralis major. In C7 level, partial innervation to triceps and latissimus dorsi and sternocostal portion of pectoralis major, complete innervation to serratus anterior. At C8 level, there are more number of muscles which are innervated. So there is partial innervation to flexor pollicis longus and brevis, and the other muscles have a very good innervation like serratus, triceps, latissimus, pectoralis major, flexor digitorum, superficialis, and brevis. So how do you train a hand function for a quadriplegic? So first important thing is you start off with a thorough neurological assessment. Along with a thorough neurological assessment, it's also important to assess them functionally to know how much functional abilities they have and how much you need to train. You can do a simple observational analysis of various functional tasks. You can ask them to perform and see how they perform it. You can even use various functional scales. You can make use of PIM, spinal cord independence measure, Barthes index, or specific hand function scales like grasp and release test, or you can use the tetraplegia hand activity questionnaire. So these scales can give you a good idea to understand how much of a hand function they have and how much they're able to use for their daily activities. And you can use these scales to see later after rehabilitating how much of an improvement they are showing. So once you have assessed, you will plan your goals, which hand activities you wish to train. The goals have to be realistic, it has to be smart goals, and you have to understand the patient's prognosis based on the level of injury, how much prognosis or recovery you can expect. Accordingly, set the goal for a hand function training. So to achieve these goals, you will have various strategies you will go ahead with. The strategies can be remedial or compensatory. So remedial as in whatever strength, range of motion and improvement you can achieve, you can get it, and then further on you can train for the hand function using those muscle activation. Those patients who don't have adequate muscle activation, you use compensatory strategies. Your compensatory strategies may be various splints or assistive devices, modified equipments, or change in the environment to allow the patient to use activities despite their motor deficit. So when you start off with the treatment intervention, first thing is the preparation. So you'll prepare for relevant range of motion, strength, adequate control of the hand. Then you start training specific to an activity. So each activity you will need to train specifically. Initial stages, you can do it in a controlled environment wherein you use different objects of different shapes, dimensions, and lighter objects, and proceed to heavier objects. And the patient learns how to pick up, release, or maneuver those objects for their hand activities. Later, you proceed to a specific functional task, preferably in an actual environment. So you can use real life environment like in the patient's home or in the occupation, wherein the patient gets to use all these trained skills of hand activity for actual work. So what strategies you will use for the hand function training? First thing is you have to check for any secondary complications, or if your patient in case has tightnesses or contractures, you need to release them. You need to make sure that the edema is prevented or treated. You need to gain a good strength in the upper limb where the muscles are partially or completely innervated. You gain strength in those muscles. You can use splints also for these patients. Splints can be used for two reasons. Either it can be for a preventive reason, as in to prevent a tightness or a contractures or a positioning of the upper limb, you may use splint. You can also use splint for a functional activity, as in the splint will support the body part to and patient to be able to do the hand activity. Other than that, you can even consider if the patient is not able to independently do hand activity, what adaptive tools and equipments you will require. Accordingly, make arrangements for it and train the patient to use it. Other forms of hand activity training is use of functional electrical stimulation. FES is commonly used mainly for the hand function in terms of upper limb. So it might be used to get a wrist extensor activation, finger flexion and extension to initiate a grasp and release. Sometimes some FES also uses stimulation of triceps to be able to extend the hand and to reach to a far away objects. So there are different forms of FES. The difficulty comes in terms of availability of this equipment, the cost. And also, this is difficult for a patient to wear it and to remove it. So, don and off is very difficult. Some patients do manage to learn and do it on their own. Quite often, they need some amount of help to use these equipments. And it requires a lot of training and understanding to be able to use it. So, it is not used very commonly, but it is one of the options which you can consider for rehabilitating the hand activity. Other options are the surgical options. Tendon transfers can be done from a stronger muscle towards a weaker muscle to gain hand function. Commonly, tendon transfers are done for gaining the wrist and finger movements and to be able to pick up objects and use them. So I'll be showing a couple of patient photos and images. These have been used with the patient's consent. So we look at the C5 level of injury. Like I mentioned, C1 to C4, since the upper limb function is absent, they cannot be trained to do any hand activities. They will need assistance for all their activities. So in C5 level of injury, the shoulder movements are good. They can do shoulder flexion, abduction, rotations. They can even do an elbow flexion, and their wrist and finger muscles are inactive. So because of the wrist and finger muscles being paralyzed, they need assistive device for hand activity. So these assistive device will be stabilizing the wrist in an optimal position, either in neutral or commonly it is done placed at a 30 degree of wrist extension to give good functional position of the wrist. So once the wrist is stabilized, the wrist will not drop in either direction, flexion or extension, and they can easily used to pick up objects, and they need other adaptive functions in the assistive device to be able to grab the objects. And these patients are able to hold the objects or maneuver the hand by using the shoulder movement. Simply, if they want to say, for example, they need a supination movement, they do have partial activation of supinator, so they can do a supination. Commonly, they do an external rotation of the shoulder to get a good supination. And when they need pronation, since it is paralyzed, they'll be doing a internal rotation to make the forearm fall into a pronation. And when they try to reach for an object, again to place the hand around the object, they use the shoulder movements quite often to position the hand around the object. And key muscles you need to work on is you need to strengthen the shoulder movements, you need to strengthen the elbow flexion, and you need to strengthen the supinator. So this is the device that they commonly use. Like you can see in the upper image, it is something like a wrist support, is something like having a static cock-up. So mostly the wrist is in a 30 degree extension position, like you can see in the upper image. In the lower image, you can see it's the wrist is at neutral. So you can vary depending on what activities the patient will be doing and how you would like to place the splint. But commonly the wrist extension position is followed. In this, you have an additional universal cuff. If you see where the spoon or the pen is attached, you have a cuff wherein there is a groove in between with a gap wherein the pen or the spoon or fork or a toothbrush can be inserted inside so that it remains in place and the patient will use the shoulder elbow movement to do the activity. So in this, like you can see, this is the first time the patient is using the universal cuff with wrist support and trying to write with a pen. So it takes time for the patients to gain good control of the movement, to be able to maneuver the object and use it. With practice, they do quite well. Initially, you can give them a simpler task, or like for eating, you can use wider bowls to pick up food. For writing, they can write in large alphabets and later try to write in the same line. And step by step, you can progress for more controlled activities. So what activities the patient can do are they can use the spoons, fork to eat, and they can place a toothbrush, brush their teeth. They can even, if suppose they have a glass or a bottle of water to drink from, commonly since it's difficult to hold them without the finger movement, what they do is they use a bilateral universal cuff with wrist support and do a bilateral grasp of the cup or the mug, and they can drink water. Quite often these patients don't have a good amount of active shoulder flexion, so to reaching to the mouth is difficult. So these patients of sometimes require spoons and fork with long handles, and sometimes with the bottle or cups, they drink using a straw. So that makes it easy for them to bring the object to the mouth for the eating purposes. So they can use this for various hand activities, and they can be independent. So only difficulty is to wear these assistive device and to remove it. They need assistance from their caregiver. Once the assistive device and the required equipments and tools are set up in front of them, they can perform the activity on their own. Other assistive device is active hand gripping aid. So in this, like you can see on the upper image, the posterior side of the device, and you can see below the front side. So this has a cuff around the wrist, and you have a strap wherein you can place any object inside and put on the strap. So it's adjustable. It can be used for any object. So when the person needs to hold something for a while, this one way to use it. So for example, instead of a weight cuff, you can tie a dumbbell to the hand with this device, and they can do upper limb exercises. They can use different objects to hold in this, and that way they can be functionally independent. Many of these patients even use power wheelchair with the joystick control. What they do is whichever hand they'll be controlling with, they use the universal cuff with wrist support, like you've seen in the upper image. So this gives them a stable wrist position, and they can push the joystick and maneuver the powered wheelchair without having to use any head or neck movement to control the wheelchair. So when it comes to C5, some of the only hand functions can be done independently. For other activities like bathing, dressing up, for catheterization, they need to take assistance. When it comes to C6, C7 injury, they are much more independent. When you have a C6 or below level spinal cord injury, or quadriplegic C6 or below, you should be able to make them maximally independent. Most of these C6, C7 patients do not use any assistive device for their hand activities. Very few might require the assistive device for few specific tasks. But it depends from patient to patient. Most of the patients I've seen have had full independent activity. So why the C6 and C7 has been clubbed up together is their hand control and activities go in a very much similar way. The main advantage of this level is the patient have activation of a wrist extensor. So when you have a wrist extensor activation, though they don't have any finger movement, they cannot flex or extend the fingers. In case of C6, C7 have slight finger flexion. But again, what happens is in these patients, for them, they have difficulty in picking up the objects. So what they do is make use of a tenodesis grasp. So what a tenodesis grasp is, they use the wrist extensor activation or relaxation to get the fingers around the object and picking up the object. So many of these patients use tenodesis grasp without requiring any assistive devices. Some might require assistive device to do this tenodesis. So the muscles you need to strengthen are the shoulder muscles, elbow muscles, even pronators work in these patients, wrist extensors. In case of C7, you have additional elbow extensor and wrist flexor which you can strengthen. So these muscles you need to strengthen in the patients. So after you strengthen this, you have to gain a tenodesis movement. So what is this tenodesis movement? So whenever the patient moves the wrist, correspondingly the finger tends to open and close on its own. So why this happens is because of the length of the flexor muscles, the long flexors of the forearm. But depending on their length, whenever the patient does a wrist extension, because of the stretch in the flexors, the fingers automatically go into a flex position. When the patient relaxes the wrist extensor and lets the wrist drop towards gravity into a flex position, automatically fingers open because the flexors are relaxed. So this can be used to easily grasp and release object without having any finger muscle activation. So though C7 have some amount of finger movement, they still need to rely on the tenodesis for grasping and of the object and releasing it. So how do you achieve the tenodesis? First thing is you need to assess the patient for how much flexor length they have. Simply you can ask the patient to do active wrist extension, or you passively move the wrist, and when you move the wrist into extension, see if the fingers are flexing, and when the wrist is taken into flexion, see if the fingers open up. If this doesn't happen, that means either the flexors may be overly tight or overly stretched. So either way, you need to get them to an optimal length to be able to do the tenodesis movement. So in case when the patient does a wrist extension or you do it passively, you see that the fingers are open, that means it may be that the flexors are very much overstretched and they need to shorten. So your treatment goal will be towards shortening and reducing the length of the flexor slightly to get the tenodresis position. Or if in case when the patient drops down the wrist, if you see the fingers are still flexed and they are not opening, or you know the fingers are constantly flexed position in any wrist movement, or you're not able to extend the wrist to a full extent, that means most likely the flexors may be stiff or spastic, then you need to stretch those muscles to gain an adequate range. So we'll be looking at two scenarios: when the hand is flaccid or there is overstretched flexor, and when it's a spastic or a stiff flexor. So when you have a flaccidity or overstretched muscle, you need to make sure that you don't keep stretching it again when you do a passive movement. So whenever you do a passive movement of the wrist, keep the finger flexed and check the passive movement, whether it's for assessment or just giving them a passive movement exercise. Again, when you want to do passive movement of the MCP or IP joints, keep the wrist flexed and IP joints flexed when you're doing an MCP flexion extension. Again, when you're doing a finger flexion extension passive movement, keep the wrist and MCP flexed and move the fingers. So this way you make sure that you're not over lengthening the flexors. And other things that you can do to gain a slight tightness in the flexors is to use a crepe bandage or a boxing glove. In this, the hand is kept in the fisted position with the thumb flexed inside and the fingers closed into a fist. Usually this support is given placed at overnight so that it doesn't interfere with the patient's daily activities or rehabilitation. So patient can wear it every night. You need to assess it daily. And once you achieve the optimal length of the flexors to achieve a tenodresis movement, you need to stop giving this crepe bandage or a boxing glove. So if in case there is a tightness or a spasticity because of which the finger opening is not adequate, then in that case you give a palmar dorsal splint. So in this splint, your wrist is usually in a slight extension. The MCP is slightly flexed and the IP joints are extended and the thumb is kept in an opposition. Again, this splint is commonly worn overnight and you need to assess daily and stop using the splint once you achieve an adequate range. So you don't want overstretched or overly tight muscle either. So once you have an optimal range to have a tenodresis movement, you stop using these splints. Some rehabilitation professionals, instead of using either one splint, they follow a regimen as using the splint alternate nights, as in one night use the flex position with a crepe bandage or a boxing glove, and another night you use the palmar dorsal splint, and they do this alternate nights. So that way you don't end up overly stretching or shortening the muscles. So that is an alternate approach which you can try. You can decide based on individual's requirement, patient's range of motion and tightness and tone, and you can decide based on your judgment which will be the best way to go ahead. So once you have adequate reach, what you do is you teach the patient how to use this tenodresis for their functional activities. So initial stages, you need to make the task very easy so that the patient can learn how to maneuver the hand just by using the wrist extensor movement and grasping and releasing objects. So the ways to make it easy is use of a bed of rice or a soft towel on the base. Like you can see in the image, you can have a ball or a basket where rice is filled and you place the object over the rice and then ask the patient to pick up and place it back for grasp and release training. Or if you don't have rice, you can just on a tabletop, you can put a soft towel and place objects on this. So this tends to make sure that the objects don't slip on the surface while the patient tries to pick them up. So it becomes easy to pick up and to grasp things. So this is the ways to initially train the patient, and preferably you start with lighter objects and later progress to heavy objects. Also start with large size objects. Larger dimension objects are easier to grab than a smaller dimension object. So you always start with the larger one and proceed to smaller ones. Another way of training to make the patient learn how to use the wrist control to hold the object is you can hold the object in the air and ask the patient to reach and grab it. That's easier than picking up an object from a surface. So that way you can train, once the patient knows how to move the wrist and hold and release the object, you can ask them to pick up objects from the table itself or from the shelves. Another ways to train is dampening the finger. You can apply moisturizer or wet the finger slightly. This reduces the chance of the object slipping off their hand and it's easier to grip. Another alternate method which some of the patients use is I tend to slide the object to the edge of the table, like you can see in the image. So once it's on the edge of the table, they push it in the web space between the thumb and index finger and grab the object. So when they're not able to pick up, this is one way they learn to use the wrist extensor control to grab the objects. Once they are very well versed with tenodesis, they can pick up from the table directly as well. Or alternate strategy is when, say, suppose when the patient tries to reach the object, they are not adequately able to understand how much wrist extension they need to do to get the finger optimal flex position to grab. One way is what they do is they place the finger down on the table where the dorsal aspect of the IP joint touches the table. And once that touches the table, it automatically tends to push it into a flexion. So they put the weight from the arm, put pressure on the fingers to get it into a flexion as much as they require. And then they just pronate the hand and get the object in between the thumb and the index finger. And then they grab it and then they pick it up. So this is alternate ways wherein the patient can try picking up and releasing objects. Once they understand how much of wrist extension they need to do depending on the size and dimension of the object and to hold, then they do it far more quickly and easily. So it's a matter of daily training. It takes time for the patient to get a judgment how to maneuver the hand and to use the objects. So once the patient has gained good control, they can do it independently. So first you start with the control environment, then you give them actual daily routine objects which they are likely to use in their daily activity at their home or for their work. And you can even practice it in the actual environment. And you can see, you know, them how they perform the activity and guide them and train them for using the tenodesis. So like you can see, patients commonly prefer using the fork and spoon in a pronated hand position instead of supination. It's easier to keep the shoulder in internal rotation and take the spoon to the mouth or a fork to the mouth. That's the common way rather than using it mid-prone or supinated forearm position. Again, for larger objects like bottle or any large size objects, the patients commonly prefer to use a bilateral tenodesis. Like you can see how the patient is holding the bottle. So bilateral grasp help them to pick up large objects. Small objects they can pick up with one hand. When it comes to using a pen or something like a paintbrush, what they do is they use a key grasp to hold. And when it comes to smaller objects, say like you can see in this gems or dice, which we use for games, they use a pincer grasp. So different grasps are used. All of it is done just by moving the wrist, the shoulder, elbow in such a way that the fingers get placed around the object and they can grasp it. So this requires a lot of practice and training. So this is how the patient performs the tenodesis for their daily activity. So they can learn to eat. They can learn to drink water. So if it is a cup or glass, they can use a single hand tenodesis. If it is a large bottle, they use bilateral tenodesis. They can comb their hair, they can brush their teeth. Upper body dressing, they can do independently. Lower body dressing, assistive devices are required. Again, catheterization, assistive devices required. For the work activities, they are also mostly doing it all independently depending on the requirements of the work. So this is how the patient is picking up a visiting card. So when it comes to very thin objects like visiting card or a paper, sheet of paper, it's difficult to grasp it from above. So the easier strategy is to slide it to the edge of the table and pick up. For larger objects of some height or thickness, you can, with training, the patient can directly pick up from the table. So this is how the patient can open the bottle or box on their own. And then since it's a bottle, the patient is using a bilateral tenodesis to pick it up. Okay. So depending on the object, they might use a unilateral or bilateral tenodesis. So you need to train both the hand for the tenodesis grasp, not just the dominant hand. So what can you do if the patient tenodesis is poor? So some of the patient, despite having good strength training for their level of injury, they do not manage to gain that tenodesis control to learn how to maneuver the wrist extension just to grasp and release objects. So some patient may not even achieve it while training. So if you have such a patient who still finds it difficult to do activities with independently with tenodesis, or some of the activities they find difficult, for those specific activities they can use splints. So you have something called as tenodesis splint. So it has a spring wherein the patient, when they move the wrist into extension or they relax the wrist, corresponding finger position, thumb position automatically gets achieved because of the spring in the device. So automatically when the wrist is extended by the patient, the finger position and the thumb opposition position gets achieved with the splint. And when the patient relaxes the wrist extensor, the fingers open up. So with this, the patient can pick up and release objects which they are not able to. And there are other modifications in the tenodesis splint wherein you have a small loop wherein you can insert a pen, like you can see in this. So pen, fork, spoon, or a toothbrush, anything can be inserted and they can do further activities. So this makes it much easier to grip these objects, especially if you have a pen which is slim, it's easier to hold this way. If the pen or fork, spoon is broader, it's you can hold it much better. The thin ones tend to slip off the fingers. So these tenodesis splint help to hold it. So you can see how the patient is using the tenodesis splint, only moving the wrist and the finger position automatically gets achieved. So you can see the spoon has an additional build-up handle of foam to make it easier to hold. So you can have such attachments to make the surface of the object broader to be easily able to hold. So this is one way. Most of the C6, C7 patients tend to learn how to don and doff this tenodesis splint. You have much simpler versions which are easier to don and doff. And to put the Velcro strap, like you can see in this image, you have a loop mostly at the end of the Velcro strap. What the patient does is, if suppose the patient is wearing the tenodesis splint on the right hand, what they do is they put the left thumb into the loop at the end of the strap, so they can pull it and wind it and place it around. And that way the patient don and doff the splint independently. And you need a simpler splint if the patient is going to be wearing it on their own. Otherwise, the caregiver will end up helping the patient. So you can train the patient for don and off. Unlike C5, where C5 needed a caregiver to don and off the splint, C6, C7 can don and off on their own. Other splints that you can make use of is that sometimes the patient thumb position is the problem. The other fingers get positioned properly for the tenodesis. Sometimes the thumb might be stiff, either the flexor pollicis longus may be too tight, or the extensor pollicis longus may be tight. So the person's thumb doesn't come in the opposition position. So you can have this thumb opening splint, which is the splint the patient can wear on their own. They can push it in with the help of the other hand, and the thumb gets positioned optimally in the opposition position. All they have to do is maneuver the wrist and get the other fingers in place around the object. The thumb position gets taken care of. Quite often it helps to make sure that the thumb doesn't become overly tight in either direction, and it's easier to position the thumb. What you can do is use of splints, like you had the palmar dorsal splint, that will take care of the thumb position, or you can use taping to achieve a adequate thumb position and prevent or treat a tightness. Other than that, if still beyond that the thumb position doesn't get positioned despite the patient trying and training, the thumb opponent splint is one option. If all the five fingers positioning is difficult, you go for the tenodesis splint. Sometimes what happens, the patient has a good tenodesis control, but some of the objects are difficult to grab, especially the ones with a thin handle, slim devices. It's difficult to grab, or some patients may manage to grasp it, but when they use it with the pressure of the hand, it keeps slipping. For example, if they want to brush a teeth, sometimes a thin handle toothbrush, while they are brushing, it just keeps slipping up and down, sliding on their hand because the grip is not adequate for smaller objects. So one way to modify and make it easy is use a universal cuff. Like in C5, you saw wrist support and universal cuff. C6, C7 just need a universal cuff. So it can be just a leather Velcro strap or a foam device wherein it has a groove in between on the palmar side where you can insert the object. So quite often patients just push the object into the device on their own, wear the device also on their own if you have a loops at the end to pull and tighten the straps, and then the patient can use it. So the difficulty with the object sliding up and down in their hand because not having a finger strength, that gets negated with these splints. If you're not using these devices, there are other assistive devices which are useful. Most of the C6, C7 patients can turn the page of a book or a newspaper on their own with a tenodesis. Those who are not good at doing it, they can use a page turner, they can wear it on their own. For typing, it's difficult to do with tenodesis. They will need to use this such kind of writing splint, or they put the universal cuff and put a stylus pen inserted into it and use that to type on the keyboard. Another thing is patients who don't have a good grip of the pen, one way is use a broader pen, or you have pen holders. It comes, you can insert, keep the pen in the center. It gives a broader base. You can hold and you can write. So patients quite often prefer that. Or alternate option is if still holding the pen is difficult when they write, the pen slips and the writing is not clear, then they can use something called as a writing ring. So writing ring comes in different forms. It usually has a support around the palm or onto the finger, and they have a loop wherein the pen can be inserted and the patient can write. So other adaptive tools, like I said, it's useful to have all the tools for daily activities with a broader handle. So you can see the spoon, toothbrush with broader handle, pens which are broad, they can be used. Or you have a built-up handle which you get ready-made commercially. You can just insert the objects into that to give a broader grip. Alternate option is you use cutlery with rings around the side, so the finger can be inserted into a ring, so less chances of slipping. For drinking with the bottle, one option is bilateral tenodesis grasp. If the patient tenodesis is not strong, you can have the bottle holders. You have mug holders, which are commercially available. Some of these bottle holders even have handles bilaterally, so they will just put their hands inside with the tenodesis and grab it and easily drink from it. So other assistive device you can see which are used for this level of injury. This is similar to a wrist support and the universal cuff which you saw for C5. C6 will not need a wrist support, even C7 will not need. You have simple Velcro straps you can use for, you know, putting it around to make sure the object doesn't slip from the hand. So this is something, a universal cuff and a toothbrush. These are objects for typing, so they put it around the hand and they can type. This is another form of a writing ring with three loops, so thumb, index and middle finger in each of these loops, and the pen is in the middle. For combing, they either need to place the comb in a universal cuff, or they can use such brush which can be easily worn in the hand. And you have such mod pieces when they want to turn on the switch on the switchboard or something like that. These objects are easy. Commonly, they use objects with larger handles. So a brush with a larger handle for bathing, it's easier to grip and it won't slip from the hand and easy to reach when the handles are long. This is a comb inserted into a long handle. You can insert any object into the long handle, use it. You can have peelers with handles which are broader and the fingers can go inside and you can grip it easily, because narrow objects again becomes difficult to grip. Again, you need to make sure that the environment is accessible, so all the door handles or supports need to be larger, so it's easy to grip. Small handles or a doorknob is difficult to maneuver for these patients using the tenodesis. So like you saw in C6 and C7, most of the patients are independent to all functional activities. Though they'll be wheelchair bound, they can use upper limb for everything, even pushing the manual wheelchair. Most of the activities are independent. C8 are a little further more independent in terms that in C8, except for the intrinsic muscles of the hand, all the muscles are intact and innervated. So they have better function in their upper limb. They can perform all the activities independently. They never require any splints or assistive devices. Sometimes for certain objects, they need to use objects with broader handles. If the object doesn't have a broader handle, you have these built-up handles you have commercially with rubber or foam. You can just insert objects into it. And you can just make it broader and easy to hold when the handle is very narrow. So that kind of modification helps them to do all the daily activities independently. So except for any fine movements, say for example, sewing or knitting or some fine minute activities, they'll not be able to perform. But rest of the most of the activities they do independently without any assistance. So in these patients, you need to train all the muscles except for the intrinsic muscles of the hand. All the muscles will be functional and they can be strengthened. So in summary, C1 to C4 don't have adequate upper limb function. They cannot do any upper limb activities or hand activities. They need to be assisted for all kinds of activities. Only the wheelchair maneuvering or using of computers, they use the head movement, mouth movement to do some of the activities on their own. They cannot be trained for hand activities. In case of C5, they can do with assistive device only. Without assistive device, again, they cannot do on their own. So universal cuff with wrist support to wrist immobilize in a functional position, they can use. The patient need help to don and off these equipments. Once everything's set up, they can do independently. C6, C7, most of the activities, they will not need any help or any assistive device. Maybe few of the tasks they might use assistive device, or some patients who are not gaining adequate control of the tenodesis, they might use assistive device for the tenodesis, like the tenodesis splints, and they need environmental modification in the devices that they hold. So broad handles, build-up handles, modified tools will make them independent to do all the activities, hand activities with the tenodesis. In C8, they don't require any assistive devices or splints except for build-up handles to have a better grip. Thank you.
Thank you so much, ma'am. It was a very nice presentation. We have some questions right now. It's a question from Gautam Murali. What are the neurological and functional assessment in details?
Neurological assessment, as in you will need a detailed history, observation assessment, you will need to check the tightness, tone, range of motion, reflexes, the coordination, everything you need to do in terms of mobility also you need to see. Again, in quadriplegic, if you have a severe or a complete quadriplegic, they will not be ambulatory, so you don't have those parameters to assess. If you have an incomplete injury or ambulating, you need to see all those aspects. So main focus for planning of the hand function is to see how much of upper limb function they have, make sure their vitals are stable. They commonly, the training happens in a sitting position, either a bed propped up or sitting on a wheelchair. So they need to be able to be sit in upright position without any difficulties. With, of course, most patients take back support for sitting. So these assessment you need to see, and wherever the patient is lacking, you have to rehabilitate them in preparation for a hand functional training. And again, for a hand function, you need to specifically see upper limb strength, which you will do in the neurological assessment. So that you need to see. And other than that, you can use various functional scales to know how much of, you know, functional independence they have for hand activities. And these scales also help you in future after rehabilitating. You can reassess with these scales. That gives you an idea as to how much recovery the patient has achieved. So that also helps you.
Ma'am, can we take up the next question, please?
One question is from Atin Sehgal and Shruti Sharma, ma'am. Can we use this universal cuff in ethetoid CP child and fine objects also, they're asking?
Yes, it can be used for various neurological conditions, not necessary for just quadriplegic. Again, it depends on the child's spasticity and tone to how easily to don and off. Quite often, the CP child needs help to don and off the universal cuff. Again, depends from case to case. In case of quadriplegic, they are C6, C7 independently don and off the universal cuff. But it can be used for other conditions.
Okay. One more question is there, like someone need to, like Mr. Prakash Kumar need to, you to explain again about a remedial strategy.
See, when you have remedial strategy, as in it's just a terminology, as in when you treat a patient commonly, not just for hand function or quadriplegic. So any patient, what you need to do is you need to see how much of assessment findings you can see, and you can judge how much of goals can be achieved. So when you want to achieve a particular goal, maybe for example, a hand function for a quadriplegic, so you need to see if the patient has adequate strength, mobility to achieve it. So then you will go for a remedial, as in you achieve that much strength in the upper limb range of motion, and you then train for the hand activity. So the patient can do it independently. So if in case the patient doesn't have adequate range, so say the patient has contractures and you cannot release it, or it's not getting the release. So, or you have, in case patient has a weakness in the muscles which are required for a particular hand activity, then in that case you go for a compensatory. Compensatory, as in you use the splints or adaptive device, environmental modifications, which will compensate for the lack of motor ability in the patient. So again, it depends from patient to patient. Remedial, as in patient can be treated to recover to do the hand function, or after recovery still there is a deficit, you add some compensatory strategies along with the remedial treatment.
My many questions are pouring in right now.
I think, Dr. Priyanka, you can take up 2-3 more questions and then they can ask
One question is from Mr. Abhavaram Johar. Many times training is becoming a problematic to train hand activities due to a lot of edema. So can you suggest some strategies in that case?
So for edema, better way is elevation. You can even do passive movements. You can use crepe bandages. Okay, so these will help to reduce the edema. Okay, sometimes even a medical management may be required to improvise the blood circulation and to prevent the edema. So you can take opinion of the physician also in those terms. And mainly, hand function is not the starting part of a person's rehabilitation. You need to first achieve the adequate level of recovery in terms of the edema and other aspects, strength and range, before you go for hand activity. So edema is a common thing in the initial stage. So make sure the patient's positioning is proper, and you can have crepe bandage compressive bandages that will help you. And sometimes even a patient with a good, giving a good nutritional guidance also helps to reduce the edemas. So simply you can take a dietitian opinion to make sure the edema is reduced.
Ma'am, is there any rehabilitation of hand function with the help of water? Hemlata, I need to ask.
I think aquatic therapy. You can do upper limb strengthening in aquatic therapy, but then when you have a hand functional training for functional aspect, you at the end you need to actually get it into a real life environment out of the water for training. So initial stage for a strengthening coordination point of view, you can start with water, and then you can go ahead with a hand functional training. That's also possible.
Why some patients have pain on their wrists? In there any solution to overcome this? Like, is there any solution to overcome this?
So, pain in the wrist can be due to various reasons. The first thing is find the actual reason for the pain. Okay, so it could be just excessive tone or a tightness, or because of edema or contractures or lack of adequate movement. So even sometimes the position is the problem. Improper positioning of the hand tends to strain the joint or the muscle. So you need to figure out what is the cause and treat the cause in the first place. And to manage the pain, different strategies that you can try is one thing is you can give medications for the pain. You can try tens for the pain relief. Sometimes it's just a matter of difficulty with the positioning or the tightness. When you address those issues, the cause, automatically the pain subsides after a while. So you can do that as well. So don't just focus on the symptomatic relief, find out the cause of the pain and work on that as well along with the pain relief. Even ice pack can be also tried, that also helps.
Ma'am, Angela, need to ask about the management in C1, C4 injury.
See, C1, C4, because of higher level injury, they don't have upper limb function. All they can do is trapezius neck movement, levator scapulae shoulder elevation, and no further movement in the upper limb. So when it comes to hand function or doing functional activities on their own, it is not possible to rehabilitate them. That is if you have a complete injury. If incomplete injury, again, you need to see below the level of injury, which muscles are spared, how much strength they have, whether the strength is adequate to train any movement, then their hand rehabilitation will be somewhat similar to a lower levels of injury, wherein there's some amount of upper limb. So you have to judge based on, say, a particular hand activity, which muscles are required to perform it, and then you correlate that which patients, you know, in the incomplete injury, below the level of injury, which muscles are spared, whether they have that much strength to do the task. And if you have a complete C1 to C4 injury, these patients mostly, C4 can be weaned off the ventilator. C1, C2, C3 require more of a ventilator support. C3 might come later into intermittent ventilation requirement. And all their movements have to be on a powered wheelchair. So C3 and C4 to some extent can use the chin controls or sip and puff with their mouth to move the wheelchair around. And if movies are very good ways to learn, if you've seen Guzarish movie, that is something like how a C4 would be. So they need help for all the activities except for maneuvering the wheelchair with the head and neck movement by pushing the chin on the control or use the sipping and puffing from the pipe. That's the only way they can move the wheelchair, provided they have adequate respiratory function, if they are able to comfortably breathe without the ventilator. So that is easy in C4. In C3, again, it becomes difficult to maneuver the wheelchair on their own because their respiratory function is limited. And every other activity, it's entirely passive. So they cannot be independent functionally.
And what recovery we can accept from an incomplete C6 level injury for a 26-year-old male? Should we take a pause in hand functional training if there is any local pathology during the training period?
You don't need to give a pause. What you need to do is, again, why a thorough neurological assessment is required is you need to know exactly how much of recovery the patient is showing. So either with a full neurological assessment, find out which muscles below the level of injury. Say if you say, suppose you have a C6 incomplete injury, so C6 complete injury as such can do all the activities independently with tenodesis. So incomplete injury would maybe, if they have wrist flexion or gripping or finger extension, they might not even need to use tenodesis. They might function something like a C8 or a T1 injury, or depending on what function they have. So if someone who's having very good upper limb recovery, you can gradually focus on the strengthening and progress. You can see how they recover. If they have good upper limb recovery, they might even do as much independent hand function as a paraplegic would do. So again, the recovery, you have to see the progress over a couple of weeks or months. Spinal cord injury rehab take months, quite often to at least a year. So it's an ongoing process. So don't decide right away. In the initial couple of weeks and months, once you have adequately managed the secondary complications like edemas and stiffness and the patient has gained some amount of strength. Say suppose initially patient is yet to recover and it's an incomplete injury. Maybe the patient starts using tenodesis and blons. After a couple of weeks, say your hand movements strength is improving. If the patient can do without the tenodesis, you strengthen the other muscles and make the patient more independent, and you can proceed further. So sometimes it helps to, in the initial phase, depending on the strength, you make them somewhat independent in view of the daily activity so that they don't have to depend on the caregiver to do it passively. So some amount of independence based on the recovery they achieve at a particular stage. And after a few weeks, months, as you continue rehabilitation, based on what further strength they show, you can modify the hand activities in such a way that they additionally use the recovered muscles as well. So you can step by step, you can reassess every few weeks, and based on that, you can decide how to modify the hand training.
Ma'am, Palvi, Kirit need to know that in some people with recent stroke, there is fast increase in tone and goes in synergistic pattern in 1 week. So what should be done in such cases?
One thing is you need to manage the tone. Excess tone is not good. Mild tone is still okay. It tends to help them to gain the function movement. So tone is not always a problem. So if there is excess tone, you need to regularly stretch or do slow passive movement. Even icing tends to help. You can even do with medications. Okay, so once you have a tone managed, you can train for movements. Simple solution is to train for upper limb strengthening in lying down position initially, because most of the quadriplegics have weakness in the scapular muscles, so their proximal stability is less, unless it's a lower level injury wherein many of the scapular muscles are working. So simple solution is have the patient in lying down, say in supine or supported sideline, and you do the movements. So gradually with strengthening, the patient can gain to move strength to move out of the synergy patterns. Then after the supine or sideline, you try later in a sitting upright position. It's easier to start off with first propped up bed position and then later go for a bed with back support or on a wheelchair, because propped up also makes it much easier than sitting on a wheelchair or a chair and doing hand activity. So if you go progress gradually, with time the patient will learn to control the synergistic movements.
One more question from Kirna Ved, that she need to have some highlights on treatment of flexor spasm in spinal cord injury.
In flexor spasm, again, main role comes with more of medical management, because it's a little difficult to handle. So a neurophysician's role is very important. And other than that, good splinting can help. Okay. And even good positioning. So it's like to stretch the muscle one way, like you do a splinting, to control the tone. There are other ways you can position the patient in such a way that the muscle is in a stretch position. For example, say the patient has a flexor spasm of the biceps frequently, what you can do is simply, patient is supine, you extend the elbow, supinate the forearm, and you can just place some weights on the forearm and keep it in same position for a couple of minutes. So that tends to gradually reduce the tone. Even if you might have flexor spasms initially, after a few minutes, the muscle tends to relax. So prolonged positional stretches help better than short duration stretches by doing stretches manually. Instead, you can do a positional stretch by pillows or use of sandbags around, or just the patient's body weight positioning the hand. Those things help. Or even for a wrist flexor stretch, say if the patient has a higher level injury and you say so much of flexor tone and you want to stretch it, even a weight bearing on the hand for a while, sitting with the weight bearing, tends to help. So somewhat if you have a C6 or C7 injury, they can easily depress the scapula because they have a good latissimus control and they can push on the hand and maintain the weight. So you just need to stabilize the hand to some extent, but they can maintain the pressure. Or C7 can even maintain an elbow extension. If in case of C6, what you can do is just put an elbow splint to keep an extension and you give a weight bearing. So these weight bearing or positional stretch help better than static hold and stretches. So these things can be done, even icing can help. So usually what we follow is do icing followed by a prolonged positional stretch. And after the positional stretch, once the tone gets more in control, then you train for the activities or strengthening, then it's much easier.
Ma'am, last question from the one whose first question we took is from Gautam. Any special test for assess the complete and partial injury?
So for knowing whether the injury is complete or incomplete, commonly Asia scale is preferred. So rather than doing top to bottom full assessment, it's easier and faster to follow Asia scale. You can even do it every couple of weeks. Sometimes, see, initially in stages of spinal shock, the patient is going to show full sensory motor loss. Even later, as the patient recovers gradually, initially someone showing a complete injury kind of picture might show incomplete injury picture later. So simple way to assess is take an Asia scale. There are simple guidelines available online. So you get an idea about the sensory motor function in that, and then you score it. So you know in that, that based on the level of injury that you decide, below that level of injury also you see the scoring. If it's more than zero, that means it's an incomplete injury. If say below a certain level, where there is good in a full innervation, say you have full score at one level, below that the sensory motor gets graded zero, it's complete. But somewhere if you see sensory one or two, or the motor function is more than zero, between 1 to 5, that means there is some amount of sensory or a motor function below the level of injury, then in that case it's showing more of an incomplete picture. And in Asia scale, they see more in terms of the S4, S5 sensory motor picture, because the sacral segments are more in the inner side of spinal cord. So if they are spared, that means it's more of an incomplete injury. If those are damaged, like S4, S5 sensory motor function is also damaged, it's more likely to be a complete injury. So even that scale can be used for a quick assessment.
Ma'am, one more question is there from Gunjan. Scale to use a hand function.
So hand function specific, if you need, there is a tetraplegia hand function questionnaire. So it has 153 component. It takes 30-45 minutes to administer the scale, but it covers questions specific to daily activities in which require hand movements, and it's specific to a tetraplegic. So it covers eating, dressing, grooming, mobility, the gallbladder care, and these aspects, even transfers, these taken care of. So there are too many components, but it covers all aspects of hand function. This is one thing you can use. If the time is a difficulty, you need to do it quicker. Option is a functional independence measure or a spinal cord independence measure. Some of the components do require upper limb function. So indirectly, you come to know whether the hand function is independent or assisted, or it's entirely maximally assisted. You get that idea with those scales also. Or you can use specific hand scales like grasp and release test, which has various objects you grasp and release and how many times you successfully pick it up. Or you can have action research arm test, ARAT test, that can also be used for checking the hand function. So there are various scales which you can use which are specific to just hand, instead of doing a full functional assessment scale. So depending on your requirement, your lookout, you can decide.
Amazing knowledge.
Ma'am, that's all for today's question. Still, if someone is having any question, they can ask through email. We'll flash the email line. Thank you so much. Over to you, Monica, ma'am.
Thank you so much, Dr. Uthana Mohan, ma'am, for this excellent and informative session and the knowledge you shared with all of us. We are really very grateful that you took out time for this webinar. This time we have got a very good response from students especially. So thank you all, and thank you to all the participants for showing interest and trusting us. I extend my sincere thanks to our IAP President, Dr. Sanjeev Jha sir, IAP Women's Cell National Head, Dr. Ruchi ma'am, and our North Zonal Head, Dr. Deepthi Gwal ma'am. Special thanks to our Women's Cell State team and our Ghaziabad IAP team for always being so supportive. We are grateful to technical team, Dr. Neha Singh, who is helping us and supporting us today. Last but not the least, my wonderful team, Dr. Priyanka and Dr. Abhivyakti, for putting in so much efforts as always. And as we conclude, I request all of you to please subscribe to our IAP YouTube channel and IAP Facebook page for the updates. Please do take good care of yourself and all your near and dear ones. My best wishes to all of you. Stay safe and healthy. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Monica. Thank you very much, you. The entire team of Ghaziabad Women's Health. It was a very wonderfully attended by all, so many people. There were approximately very many people going upon to the YouTube watching you all on live. So thank you to the entire team. I, Dr. Neha Singh, on behalf of IAP Digital team, would like to make an important announcement regarding that there are a few steps to update your membership of IAP and to stay and to continue to be the active member of IAP. So I urge all of you to kindly go through our IAP official website and then enter the website through and click onto the notices. There you shall be getting a Google form where you will have to fill up the Google form and upload the picture of your existing IAP membership certificate. And after you submit that, it will be very much grateful for all of you to continue be... Hello? Yes, to continue to be the active member of IAP. So I urge all of you to kindly update your IAP membership. And thank you once again to all the participants for giving your evening. And it was a very well executed workshop for today by the team of Ghaziabad. Thank you, Dr. Uttara ma'am, for being all of us, for thank giving your you, knowledge on this team. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you, Uttara ma'am. Thank you, Neha ma'am. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you, Dr. Neha, for the digital support. And also thank you to the Ghaziabad team, Dr. Monica, Dr. Abhivyakti and Dr. Priyanka. And I hope I could share information with the audience. If you have any further questions, you can put it on the email ID which I've shared in the chat.
Yes, it was a very well explanative session. Thank you, Uttara ma'am.
Indeed.